much to tell you what you think. Don't look any money at me. Let's say Beechwood, we became involved in the sort of the food feed in Birkenhead through Frank Field and a few meetings we had which resulted in a presentation at one of the Feed in Birkenhead meetings by his church, which is a religious Christian charity, which also resulted in us making a visit with Joe Wirral and Sheena and a couple of other people to actually see what was involved. And basically the deal was that you go there and you buy pallets of non-perishable food, which you buy for £150 and for £30 carriage charge on it. And then there's a cleaning pallet as well that you can buy. So there's a value on it of about £1,200. And if I say since our visit, we've actually had 30 pallets, that's about 4 pallets a month. And what the main reading of all is that you cannot sell the items that you have. You invite a donation from people, and they offer whatever they can afford. Or if they can't afford it, what we do is say, well, can you volunteer on the project and give some time that way? And with the food, Linda Finn and her daughter Emma have managed the project very well with the pallets, so that we've actually had a surplus of £1,000, which enables us then to purchase more pallets. And that's the secret to it all. And I suppose, if other people could do that, they could do what we're doing. One of the other things we're also doing is we've done the asset transfer of the Beechwood Community Centre, which took place in early December, and the work is now starting on the refurbishment. And the main area now, we're going to put a cafeteria inside there, and our intention is to provide breakfast and after school meals, hot meals for young children who need it, and wherever possible do it for free. We've also on the beach, we've got our own food hub, which is an official food hub. It's not part of the Trussell setup, and this is run by the parishioners of Jackal on Beechwood. And what we've done through Linda, she has helped many people and the food bank itself by providing food from the palace to keep people going. I suppose for me, and I've been around a long time, is that one of the most disturbing things I ever came across in the last 12 months was a guy that I spoke to who told me that he hadn't eaten for 5 days. And I can show that it's totally unacceptable in the society we live in. And his problem is benefits. And, when he had his benefits stopped. So what I'm saying is the key to all this food is benefit advice. And that's what we need to supply to people. But I would also like to say a big thanks to the constituent panel, especially Joe. She's got quite a dynamic view of all this and has been very receptive to everything we've done. So thank you.
Basically just all getting together. Now with lifelong learning we can provide courses for volunteers throughout Birkenhead, Seeker, Noctorum, Beechwood, and we are hoping to be working quite soon with Beechwood on a course for volunteers, Noctorum and in Seeker. Those courses can be anything from making table decorations, it could be how to grow food, it could be creating allotments, creating events which are based around recycling, anything whatsoever that has to do with the environment. But there's obviously details of things that are involved, but if you want to know any more information, if you get in touch with Cllr or Joe, they'll be able to put you in contact with us.
Thank you. the end of the update in terms of the food hubs. And I just feel so proud, I'm sure everyone around this table will feel the same way, about all the work and the dedication of the people who've been doing this all through the year. So 2016 is over now. 2017 is just going to start, and it's a big challenge. That challenge is still out there, where people are desperate for food, desperate for help, desperate for the inquiries in terms of welfare. So please keep up the good work, the excellent work that you've been doing all year, and feel very, very proud of yourselves. Well done to everyone.
Sure that you can provide the best service to our community. So, ground, so if we now have all our detectives working from Birkenhead Police Station and they will investigate crime, that provides everyone with a consistent approach. So you've just got investigators dealing with crime now, whereas we had lots of different police officers, not necessarily specialised investigating crime before. That's what we've got now, providing, as I say, that consistency. And we also have, within that, we've got trained officers looking at our protecting our vulnerable individuals in society, our most vulnerable, looking at our domestic violence. As I say, really focusing on a consistent approach and making sure everyone gets a really positive experience when they, if they happen to suffer a crime. Local policing, that's what myself and my colleagues do. We are your community policing team, local policing team. We have, what we've done is we've stripped back our supervision. So now we have whereas previously we used to have a chief superintendent, a superintendent, two chief inspectors, four neighbourhood inspectors. Now what we have is one superintendent, one chief inspector, and two local policing inspectors. So we've really cut down on our hierarchy to make some savings, but what we still have is the same number of officers, constables, sergeants out there on the streets, providing a really efficient policing service. So neighbourhood inspectors, I am one of those, and I'm based at Bennington Police Station. I have a policing team there, including the wonderful Kate and Danny. And as I say, it's a larger geographical area now. It covers Birkenhead and it will go down to Eastham, Bromborough, over to Heswall, and obviously Bevington. And then the other local policing hub is at Wallasey, and that is, as I say, again, it's larger than it used to be. That incorporates Upton, Hoylake, West Kirby, and all of those areas. But the same number of staff, constables, and PCSOs and sergeants to police those areas. So, it just means that we've got the same visibility out there, we've got the same service to you all, but hopefully we're working more efficiently and we'll be able to deal, we're not there investigating crime, we're working on problem solving and dealing with community issues. We're also working at looking at community safety hubs, and we're working with the council ASB team, community patrol, really maximising those resources and getting out using additional vehicles, patrolling with those members of staff and problem-solving issues much more efficiently. So you can read that for yourself, what does it mean? Hopefully our 999 calls will be responded to more efficiently, our investigation processes are better, more efficient, more consistent. So there are two neighbourhood policing teams, one at Wallasey, one at Bevington, and we also have our community policing hubs out there. So we have one at St James Centre, on Laird Street, one at Rock Ferry's One Stop Shop, Mortimer Library, Boylake Community Centre. There's also one in the town centre that's sort of subject to a little bit of change at the moment. So that's what's happening with policing, I suppose, across Merseyside, but try to make it a little bit Wirral specific. But now, I've shouted at you for a couple of minutes, I'll hand over to Kate, she'll tell you about some of the really good work that's going on in the North End.
Good evening. First thing I just want to mention for everybody is the cumulative impact policy. For those of you that don't understand what that is, it's a tool within the licensing legislation that the council would apply if they chose, if it was necessary, where they can designate an area to be needing a cumulative impact policy, which basically means we have enough licensed premises that are selling alcohol either on license or off license, and if people want to apply for a new license, they have to then justify how and explain how they are not going to add cumulative impact policy of licensing. I've written to the local licensing manager with regards to Birkenhead Town Centre. I've put the map up on here on there so that you can all see it. That's the area where at the minute we're looking for the public to come back and consult with the local authorities to say, yes, I think this is a good idea, or no, I don't, and to give you all reasons as to why that is. If you want to get further information about that, then please go look on the council website, because it's the licensing department that you need to go back to. But we've asked for that particularly to help assist with some of the issues that we've got with the street drinking in Birkenhead Town Centre. ASB within the North End. A number of you may be aware that we had quite a number of issues of antisocial behaviour.
is about the care of the young people and keeping them away from that sort of risk-taking behaviour on the street and being a sort of a non-judgmental sort of adult on the street where they can approach and they can engage with us and we can support them into making changes in their life.
Speak today. My name is Dan Murphy. I'm a neighbourhood sergeant for the town centre at the moment. My presentation is a bit different. There's a lot of images on it. Some are negative, but hopefully take the good positive images. In the end, hopefully some positive stories will come across. So hopefully that's the aim. Can I just pass this round, just to go around, just to play on and talk about it? Today obviously I'm here to talk about the Seven Peaks project. A funded project that was started. We started in relation to different problems up there who have suffering, mainly poverty and antisocial behaviour. I put a graphic up there, obviously just shows the area, but it just says there's a lot of change going on at the moment, especially with this being stopped as well as the Seven Peaks project finishing, but also the changes in the police that are coming. So the graphic there, obviously, I don't know whether you can read it. Basically says change here, it's essentially even when it's self-administered. So obviously we all have to go through change and it's inevitable. The issues that we have had, graphic there, it's in relation to poverty. And that's nationally, but that obviously applies to Birkenhead as well, as we all know. And there's a lot of work going on in the room as we heard just before. Another graphic there as well. This is the problem that we have dealing with these youths in Birkenhead, and it is only a small minority of youths that are engaged in this type of behaviour. And you've got to ask yourself the question, how have they got so out of step with society that they're doing that type of behaviour? And that's a problem that, you know, we're going to have to start looking at and finding out what is causing them to distance themselves from civilised society. And obviously that's a deep problem that we need to look at as the police and our partners. Now it's a graphic for centralisation. Essentially what Chief Inspector was talking about is the centralisation model that's coming in within the police. Now, it's not all bad for Birkenhead. Essentially, the units go to where the need is, the patrols go to where the need is. For instance, as a neighbourhood sergeant, if I pay for resources to come and solve problems in Birkenhead, I will get the resources, essentially, because Birkenhead will need resources. And you could potentially get resources coming from Liverpool to come to Birkenhead to fill the gaps. But unfortunately, likewise, and there will be a few teething problems along the way with the new operating model. But be assured, Birkenhead will still get a good service from the police. Right, we still will be doing the closure orders. We've been doing a lot of them recently. And the enforcement side of things, we're still going to be doing that very much. As I said, there is still going to be a neighbourhood team in Birkenhead that's dedicated to Birkenhead. As I said, we can bid for resources, and as the resources are centralised, if we identify problems in Birkenhead, we will get resources to help us in that enforcement. Okay, put that graphic up there, and it's all about ideas. The police now, we've been freed up slightly with this new operating model, and we're given more focus on finding innovative ideas to try and solve some long-standing problems. And obviously Joe's phone's been going off the hook, hasn't it, with me, with ridiculous ideas ringing you up. Most recent one was trying to open up the police stations for ghost hunters. Obviously up all the old haunted police stations. For charity, that's something that's going to potentially come off. And we're looking at where with restorative justice as well. Obviously looking at where all over the world, and essentially looking at where from Canada in relation to restorative justice. Okay, I just want to introduce the play. This is a really good bit of partnership work and essentially looking at the problems that we get with antisocial behaviour and how we want to change the attitudes amongst young people in relation to how it affects people. If you haven't seen this, there's a brochure going around at the moment. It was screened in November and December. We've had a lot of help from the council on it, who are our partners on it. It's something really to be proud of. The play is really hard hitting. And it basically shows, I won't ruin it, but it it's really hard hit and play, and it's made to make children think, or school children particularly, have been shown to think about their behaviours and how the impact of their behaviours and what it has on the victims. I think it's very effective in what it does. So that was an idea at first. It was a bit bizarre that we talked about, wasn't it? But it's managed to come off. Some ideas don't, some do. But this is a real winner. We're hoping Jean's making inquiries at the moment to try and get it in the Gladstone, possibly, or the Pacific Rollers, or the floor as well. Obviously, there's a big cost for it, so we're looking for the cheapest place that we can really keep the funding down. There's some pictures from there. Got the police horses. Difficult to see. Jane Kennedy is in the pink jacket, the Police and Crime Commissioner. George is on the end there. Got Baroness Helen Newlove. Now, Helen Newlove, her husband was murdered in 2007. By a group of thugs who lived, who were at the end of their road, unfortunately. Now she gave a talk on the day on the open event, and she was giving her view of what she's been through and her social behaviour, and it really hits home. A lot of people crying listening to her, and even as a police officer listening to what she went through with the criminal justice system, it was really shocking to listen to. So overall, it's positive. Picture of the cast, and you might recognise the fellow right outside, Pete Price. Pete Price is a real champion of the play as well, and as I said, the play is, essentially is a production, a partnership production. Obviously there's an image there, that's actually taken in Birkenhead. It's just to emphasise, obviously, moving on again, taking a different tact. The problems in the town centre that we have, and these people unfortunately sleep in there. Quite often there's so much support for them, and the people we speak to, the outreach, say quite often they have a choice, they have somewhere to go and stay, but there are issues stopping them going to those places like the night shelters. There's dynamics with individuals who don't get on with whoever, and obviously a huge amount of poverty. What we're doing with that, another idea. We're looking for ages for a central hub that we could use to go hand in hand with the youth club. Now this place here, the Liberty Centre, there's loads of other adventures in Birkenhead, but this is central Whetstone Lane. And what we're hoping to do is, Ian O'Rubby is running it from the Liberty Church. And what he's hoping to do is have a drop-in centre for the vulnerable street drinkers, as sometimes referred to the vulnerable homeless as well. Trying to get them in and teach them life skills like cooking, and also he's looking at opening a food bank there. Obviously it's work in progress that Joe's done a lot of hard work on, as all the people in the police and the council. Yeah, so we're hoping that's going to open in the next month or so. I hope it's going to be a positive, overall positive. And there's some pictures of Bobby in the town centre. Always very popular. Quite often the police actually enjoy Bobby more than the public do. But the kids absolutely loved him. That was Halloween out there with the bid team as well. And obviously Kirsty McHugh there for the outreach teams. And again, more pictures of the kids following around. And again, that was at Christmas, hence the tinsel. That was really popular in the Christmas holidays with the girls. Right, we'll move on to Alligates now. There's some really good work obviously being done on the Alligates. Some people here might actually be involved. I know it's a fantastic project. You look at the state of some of the alleyways there, and then look at this other picture, other image.
Yeah.
And that's just off Cllr Road. That event was really well received. Sarah Preston from the bid team, I know some of our officers went as well, but Sarah from the bid team said there's been a lot of positive feedback on Twitter and Facebook about this, and it's gone. Quite wide ranging, so basically the impression of Birkenhead is almost, people are really interested in looking at this rather than the graphic we showed before, but down on some streets. It's a really good image. There's some of the new community hubs that we expect to talk about, and that's quite an interesting image that I've used before. I think it's quite well done, which demonstrates partnership work, and that's the end of my presentation. Is there any questions? No? No questions. Thank you very much.
seen in the press in the last week, and also an online petition. Now, that's the only place that I've seen anything about parking charges. And what I'd like to know is, are we going to have an opportunity to discuss this with the council?
Yeah, there's a consultation going on at the moment, so there's a space on the council's website where people can leave comments. I think there's something in the Globe this week where people can register comments. So there's it's a consultation exercise. But the background to this, you may be aware that we're having to make £45 million worth of cuts in the budget next year because the government are cutting our grants. So we've got to obviously identify where that's going to come from. But clearly we want to hear from residents first. So there is an opportunity through the council website, through what's on the Globe, for people to record their comments.
It's not only involved, this is not only a financial matter. You're looking at the quality of life of people, because in one particular area, that's in New Brighton on the Crom. If you introduce charges to the Crom, that will make the likes of Morrison's also introduce charges. Because if they don't do that, then you're going to get people coming for a day out, parking in Morrison's because it's free, and that is no good for Morrison's and the shoppers. So what will then happen? You'll have a knock-on effect, and you will have all the roads leading down to New Brighton Crom that will be congested, and then you will have problems for residents parking in that area. So saying that maybe we should, you know, just go online and put something down, is there anything in place where there will be a public debate to allow the public to turn up and put their points forward to the council?
Well, there will be an opportunity for a public debate, because when the council sets the budget, there'll be a debate in the council chamber. But clearly, we're doing a consultation now so that members of the public can put their views forward on all the proposals. So by the time the council comes to make its budget, we can make an informed decision based on a whole range of factors, including the views of residents.
When do you think that a decision or a debate, when do you think that will be taking place?
Well, the council will set a budget on the 6th of March, right. Budget council. The consultation lasts, I think, for the next couple of weeks on the budget proposals.
There's also, just to interrupt that, there's also a scrutiny committee meeting next Tuesday night where this will be raised as well.
Right, where's that?
Wallasey Town Hall.
Brilliant.
Wallasey Town Hall, committee room.
Excellent, thank you very much. Okay.
6 o'clock.
Yeah.
And that's for all constituencies?
Yeah, it's up to 10.
What time was it?
Six.
I think if I'm right, it's going to look at a number of proposals that have been put forward,
yes.
For the budget, not just the parking charges, but the whole range that have been.
So that's the one money talking.
And I have to say, it's a scrutiny committee, so the members who will be discussing it.
Oh,
it's
kind of the
public can vote. It meets in public, but you won't be able to.
You won't be able to speak.
Yes, you won't be able to listen to the council's debating.
It is a private session. Yeah, so it's a private session, but obviously members will be able to raise the issue raised by residents on their behalf.
Yeah.
Okay, any other helping?
I've got a piece.
You don't want
just
one.
Just relation to the food provision and the grants. I'm wondering, rather than take the time tonight, if Joe will facilitate a meeting with me and those who are taking applications, particularly to look at perhaps encouraging St. Paul's, who I think they've got an allocation of £5,000, and I think from what you told me yesterday, that's been matched by another £5,000. I'm not objecting to it, I'm just thinking that there's a possibility there to extend what's on offer there, and perhaps work with George to get the meal provision during school holidays underway there as part of that bid. And I'd like to see if we can progress that.
Yep,
okay.
Facilitate meeting with St. Paul's and George. Do you want the food task group to be involved?
Well, I think I've spoken to most of the food task group. I think they understand the point I'm making. But it would probably, since they're responsible for allocating the money,
course of the presentation by the police, they were talking about changes in their structure, which are being finalised, I think, over the next 2 weeks. It would be helpful, I think, when they are finalised, if members could have the detail of the new contact, the new structure, the new contact details, etc., when they become available.
As I understand it, we've arranged or we asked Amy to come and give a talk to members for an open meeting.
He did that a week ago.
2 weeks ago.
Yeah. Ian Hansel, the area manager. It was an open to all members. But I'm sure.
I got the impression that the new structures will be finalised in the next couple of weeks. So I imagine the event that clearly I've missed.
It was
probably more of a consultation, a feedback to say this is what I'm thinking. It's clearly a matter for the operational side of the police and the driving commissioner to decide the structure that she would want. But when those decisions are made, I think my plea is as soon as possible, if we can know the new addresses, email addresses, contact names, that would be much appreciated, certainly by me.
Absolutely. Okay. Anybody else? One at the back. Yeah.
I enjoyed looking to the community and Sisters and Sailors. We've started to plan our gospel programme. So we're asking anybody who have any needs to be raised aged 16 to 17, would that be part of the programme? We put them forward for ourselves. And obviously we don't go on a professional programme for 4 weeks in the summer. We have 13 programmes as well, where the young people go out into the communities and serve the communities and put programmes in the communities to give something back. So then we've got any ideas within the community or anything that's what needs to be done within our local communities, just like the third one, we obviously have teams there and try and work with the communities themselves and give something back in the community to these young people.
So Julie, are you looking for community groups to host placements or is it not engineering?
Some of them were to do anything, whether it's painting gardens or it's actually putting gardens in flower beds or whatever. Anything that the young people can serve in the community, give back to the community, have to get 30 hours back to service. So we're just trying to see if there's anything out there that you can think of something that these young people can do through the summer. I can send the data across to everyone to the way and we can do the activities. And in the meantime, it's also, I've sent an email to all councillors. It might be part of our day in Walton Town Hall. It's just letting everybody know we've still got places if we want someone to come along and be part of it and serve ourselves. Volunteering in the night. So